So that I have taken up with somebody's, I don't know, job profile, taken up with the appearance of somebody, I'm taken up by the nature of somebody. All that is good during the engagement period. That attracts two people together, but very soon that fades away. So you cannot make marriage depend on these conditions. Marriage has to be based on love. And these are the points that St. Paul talks about in love. And therefore the Pope says, love that is weak, incapable of accepting marriage as a challenge. Every single marriage goes through challenges. I mean, those of you who are married have no experience in that. You don't have any experience of that, except talking to people who come for counseling or for assistance. Therefore, a love that is weak, what happens? That is incapable of accepting marriage as a challenge, cannot sustain the commitment. And sooner or later, such a marriage without love will succumb to the culture of the ephemeral. You will look for satisfaction elsewhere and not in each other. And that is what contributes towards the breakdown of marriages. So therefore, a love that is weak, that is why we have to constantly work on love. Love is something that grows. And as the Pope is talking to married couples, I'm thinking of us priests. If we priests don't grow in our ability to love the church, to love the people of God, we are married to the church. And if our love for people, for the church, for the things of God is weak, then our priesthood is ending up on the rocks. So it's a very important point about the culture of the ephemeral. Ephemeral means worldly. Then we look for other satisfactions because our love for each other has grown weak. Therefore, the joy of love needs to be cultivated. None of us can say, I have reached the zenith, I have reached my perfection of love, I cannot love more than this one. It's a daily growing in love. It's a growing effort to be able to love. And the only example I can think of is Jesus and Mother Mary, right up to the foot of the cross. Okay, so that is what gives us Christians a lot of courage to sustain our love in marriage when we are challenged. Now, see how practical the Pope is. When the search for pleasure becomes obsessive, love is weak. Love is not pleasure. So when that becomes obsessive, when I want to satisfy my own selfish desires, that is not love. We become captives, we become slaves. And then when I am not satisfied, when my desire for pleasure is not met, then I lose control of myself, and then marriage goes through difficult times. Marital joy can be experienced even in the midst of sorrow. So joy in marriage is not when everything is going very smoothly. That, yes, that gives us a lot of encouragement. But we need to experience this joy even when there are problems, even when there is sorrow, even when there is sadness. We support each other. An inevitable mixture of enjoyment and struggles, pain and relief, annoyances and satisfaction, even when physical pleasure has ebbed. And this is a big problem today when marriages break. The spouses get tired of each other and they're looking outside for their pleasure. And that is the end of joy. Because such type of situations never bring us joy, never bring us fulfillment. Because there's always that guilt, there's always that thing that we carry along with us. So that is not love in marriage. Love in marriage is actually tenderness. Tenderness is a sign of love free from selfish possessions. Possessiveness. I think this is a very important sentence. The only way to overcome selfish possessiveness, and this is for everybody, including us priests, is tenderness, is an honest, deep love for the other person. Once we have become selfish, once we want to satisfy our own needs, then that is no more love. We begin, as somebody said very correctly, we begin to love things and possess we begin to love things and not to love persons. Sex outside marriage, rape of children and of women and all sort of things. Because this erotic love, which is wrongly understood and which is just given freedom, it's a libido as they call it, no? That everyone is doing it so I can do it. No. But in marriage, it is required to strengthen this conjugal love, and therefore the sexual act in marriage is the climax of a loving relationship. And this is what makes loving and healthy families. The sexual act in marriage is not dominance, is not hurtful, is not demanding. It comes out of this passion and erotic love for one another. And therefore the next paragraph is important. Sex becomes depersonalized and unhealthy. When it becomes depersonalized and unhealthy, I'm talking of sexual love and marriage, I'm not outside marriage. When there is self-assertion, I want, you must give it to me. Selfish satisfaction risks being poisoned by the mentality of use and discard. This is a very sad thing in marriage. This undermines the whole aspect of love in marriage. What is expected to be a real act of love becomes now a selfish satisfaction. See how the Pope is talking about practical issues. He's not giving us some theology of love or some high-flown language. And the language of this book, this exhortation, is very simple. Any one of you opening the book will be able to understand what he's saying and will literally enjoy what he's saying. Enjoy in the sense that it will really enrich your marriage. What I'm giving you here is a summary. He's just picking up the important points. But when you read the book and the way the Pope expands these ideas, it is really beautiful. When this happens, use and discard, what happens? The body is viewed as an object. The body is never an object. The body is a gift of God. Our body does not belong to us. Our body is given to us by God. And when we die, this body will go back to God. So it's not just an object to be used and thrown away. The Pope often talks about throw-away culture, especially with regard to old people. When old people become a burden to the family, they become throw-away culture. Everybody is putting them in a home for the aged, everybody leaving them alone, everybody giving them to caretakers, etc. Throwaway culture. The Pope is very concerned about old people. He says you have to take care of them. I think he mentions it towards the end. Okay, so this whole idea of the body not to be rejected once it is no longer appealing. You loved this man before marriage. You were attracted to him. You loved this wife, this girl before you got married. Now that appeal is gone, that doesn't mean that therefore you can discard. It's not love in marriage. The Pope comes up to very, very practical issues. And if you pay attention to this, and we could really work at healthy marriages in our parishes, in our neighborhoods, in our society, what a wonderful society we would have. Because as I told you, most of the problems that we are facing today is because of problems of family and marriage. And that is why the Pope is so concerned about families and about marriage. Okay, we've come to chapter 5. I don't intend finishing all the 9 chapters today, but we shall take as much as we can so that we need. Let's take a little break in the sense of any questions or any reactions to not what I am saying, but what Francis is saying. I'd be very happy to listen to some of you. I've gone up quite fast. You can imagine I finished 4 chapters in and we have finished at 8, right? Okay, so I'll try to keep to the time. Any quick remarks, any quick sharing, any thoughts that were going through your mind during this presentation? Any question that you'd like to clarify, to ask?
In marriage.
not shout at God and blame God. Okay? So that is part of human suffering, etc. As far as surrogacy is involved. As far as in vitro fertilization outside the womb is concerned, it's true that science gives this and they use it for the lower form of the creation, which is animals. But that is not what God intended when He created man and woman. Okay? For a child to be born outside the womb. So this is what the church is saying. Now if you ask me, is it a mortal sin? It is. I may not be able to go that far. But I'm giving you the religious understanding of what marriage, conception, and the role of man and woman is according to God's plan. Yeah? I hope I answered your question. Thank you. Yes?
Thank you, Father. Father, I'm a bit confused. You say that the Catholic Church has not allowed divorce, don't allow separation. And again, you told us that Pope Francis is allowing people who are divorced previously, the married and divorced, and he's a. Sorry?
And remarried?
They were married before, divorced, then now they're coming back together.
With another woman?
With another man.
Yeah, remarried. Divorced and remarried.
So isn't that a contradiction?
Okay, so this is one of what are called the most controversial issues of this exhortation. And a lot of people have thrown stones at Pope Francis exactly for this, and many brought it up. Because, especially the conservative cardinals and bishops, they say the Pope is changing it. The Pope has not said this. The Pope is saying we need to study the situation. Because people are suffering without the eunuchs. So he has not said yes. He said maybe at a future date, after study, etc., this law could change, the law of the church. God didn't come down to say you cannot receive Holy Communion. And it is put there to protect marriage. To protect marriage. Okay? For no other reason. So if I throw away my spouse and I take another spouse, I have broken communion with the church, with the family of God, and therefore I cannot come to Holy Communion. Is that clear? That is why a divorced and remarried person cannot receive the Eucharist. Now, the Pope says, suppose one party was really suffering in the first marriage, innocently. And now that party, out of desperation, and for the sake of the children maybe, entered into another marriage. So the next day the person cannot go to Holy Communion. But there needs to be a discernment made. That's why you notice the Pope says that there is stability in that marriage. If the children of the new marriage are being taken care of and well brought up, if there is real love between the two, he puts on these conditions. So he says if the church can study these conditions and maybe at a later date say, but it's not a general permission, that is the whole trouble. So you cannot say, now that party is receiving communion, why I am not giving communion? So it's a very difficult point, it's a very difficult point, and a discernment has to be made with the priest and the bishop. And it can be given only in individual cases. That is why it is very controversial. But please don't say, Father Wilfred said now you can receive permission. The Pope has not given permission. Having said that, I can tell you that in Europe, I think it's in Germany, some bishops have already gone ahead and permitted divorce and remarried to receive communion. But the Pope the church has not accepted this. Am I clear on this point?
Yes.
Please don't misunderstand me and please don't misquote me. Okay? You have the paragraph number, you can check in the book and the exhortation. See, the Pope is a man of compassion. He says if these people really understand the strength of the Eucharist and are really hungering for the Eucharist, then the church, like a good mother, out of care for this person, must be able to assist them. That's all he's saying. Okay? But he's not giving permission. Because it will disrupt the, as you said very correctly, it will be a contradiction and disrupt the whole understanding of marriage. Because divorces are on the increase. Right throughout the world. Because people today don't have the strength to face the challenges of marriage. So the easiest way is to throw away the spouse and get another one. Go to the market and buy another one. Use and
discard.
So if the Pope says, okay, you can do it, then marriage is completely ruined. Okay? So that would be a contradiction. So please understand that the church is not saying you can do it. The church has not approved of this. The Pope is only talking about compassion for these people who are now in a stable relationship, whereas before they were in a horrible relationship. There was no marriage, there was no love. Can you give me 5 minutes more?
One question. In regards to the last part where you say the body is viewed as an object as it offers satisfaction and rejected once it's no longer appealing. So my question veers off a little bit. I want to ask about the stand of the church. In matters of cremation of the body.
Cremation?
Yes. And also in regards to the creed, when we say, I believe in the resurrection of the body, what's the take of the church?
Okay, good question. See, what happens when a person is buried? At that point, and the person dies, his spirit goes to God. Right? Or is damned for all eternity. So particular judgment is already done at the moment of death for the spirit. Now the body is still here. When the body is buried, what happens? It becomes dust, it is mixed up with the dust. So at the last coming, the resurrection of the dead, can you distinguish, no, this is dust, this is the body? You can. So this is purely a matter of faith. That on the last day, there is a resurrection of the body. Because you believe in this, you say it in the creed, right? Now the same combination. It's not dust, but it's ashes. So therefore, the church has today, after studying this for many, many years, said creation is permitted on 2 conditions. And the first condition is actually this, that the person who says, I want my body to be cremated after my death, believes in the resurrection. Okay? So the person is now saying, I want to be cremated because I don't believe in the resurrection, I don't believe in the afterlife. That is wrong. That is immoral. Catholic teaching. Second point is, those ashes have to be respected. So I cannot do what the Hindus do. They get on the boat, they take the ashes and they just throw them to the wind and get dissolved in the water because they don't believe in the afterlife. So just as we believe that this dust will rise on the last day, we believe that these ashes will rise on the last day. So that body is put in a grave. Those ashes are put in an urn, and normally that urn is put in a vault in a cemetery. It doesn't need a 6-foot grave. But it has to be respected, and the person has to believe in the resurrection. So we are not contradicting the article of the creed that says, I believe in the resurrection of the body. And that's the last one. Is it clear? Okay. Okay, let's see if we can continue the remaining. Yeah, Thursday. Okay. Thanks for your attendance. I'm very happy to see so many of you. And thanks for your attention. I'm looking around. I didn't find anybody dozing or anybody distracted. Thanks for your attention. Yes? One more question? Okay.
Thank you for that. Marriage and holy orders, they are both vocations.
Marriage and?
Holy orders.
Holy orders, yes, yes.
Now, when we look at holy orders, especially for the priest, you take about 12 years of formation to be ordained. When you look at marriage, it depends on the circumstances. 1 week, 2 months, 1 year. On top of that, fathers, you still undergo formations.
Ongoing formations.
Marriage, it's like after marriage. Now,
we start
calling each other. When the church includes precedence of every 2 years, maybe when you get a child, if you don't get a child, you know, some people come, they say, okay, we renew our vows, marital vows. Maybe they do it just symbolically because they are saying, can you renew your vows? But they don't mean it. And challenges are there after the action. They are still looking at each other like they are enemies.
Okay, that's a very good question. I'm glad you brought it up. A little later, I think you'll find it on the screen in one of the other chapters. You know what the Pope says? When does preparation for marriage begin? When does preparation for marriage begin? At birth. At birth. So the child who is born in a good family, who is brought up with Catholic principles, is preparing for a good marriage. So that is why we need healthy marriages. That is one part of the answer. The other part of the answer, I'll tell you what we have in Bombay. In Bombay now, we have compulsory marriage preparation courses that have to be done 3 months before marriage. And if you don't do that, the priest will not accept your prenuptial inquiry forms. You first go and complete your marriage preparation course. So the dioceses there are very strict about these courses. But anyway, I can just go and attend the course and just come back and say, I did the course. But the importance of this course is go to them. Then, when the parents are expecting their first child, they have what's called a pre-baptismal course. So they call back, they explain the meaning of marriage, of children, etc. But apart from all this, the Pope is calling, he said this year, calling for lay associations and parish cells to take care of marriages. Which is exactly what you said. The first 3 years of marriage, the first 5 years of marriage, the first 10 years of marriage, the first whatever. You have to bring couples together to share experiences, to share good practices, to encourage each other. So this is the work of the church. Pastoral care of marriages. Very important point that you brought up. So that is why in our parishes, the family cells have a lot of work to do. Unfortunately, what happens, those who need help, they push these people away. Don't interfere in our life. We know what to do. Unfortunately, that happens. But if it becomes a regular, approach to people, then people will understand that we need to come together to support one another in marriage because of all the challenges that are happening. So I agree with you perfectly. It's like for us priests. Some priests say, I don't need any courses, I know what to do, don't tell me what to do. So the means are there, but the means can be rejected. And the church is very concerned, and especially Pope Francis is concerned. So thanks very much once again for your attention. Can you stand up? We'll just conclude with a prayer.
Fundamental values of happy life. We know the challenges that marriages are going through. We know the responsibilities that husband and wife have to hold on their shoulders. We know the difficulties that young people are facing today when they look at broken marriages, unhappy marriages, marriages that are lived without joy and fulfillment. We pray especially tonight for our young people that they may overcome the negativity that prevents them from looking forward to a good married life that will take them until death do them part. We pray for all our married couples, particularly those attached to this shrine, that Mother Mary may walk with them day after day, even if they find themselves carrying heavy crosses as she accompanied the Son to Calvary at the foot of the cross. May our Blessed Mother intervene in those families that are going through difficult situations and bring them the grace and the strength to overcome those difficult situations and to find the joy of love that Pope Francis so earnestly desires for the Church. We make this prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
The Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
See how love is made fruitful. So love is not just an idea, is not just a virtue, but love has to be fruitful. And that is for how Pope Francis explains it in chapter 5. Okay, so he begins by saying, love always gives life. So love is fruitful when it brings life. The family is the setting in which a new life is not only born but also welcomed as a gift of God. Children are loved even before they arrive. It's a very interesting observation of Pope Francis. So it's not just bringing a child into the world, it's bringing a child as a gift of God. And so therefore, we love this child before it arrives. And yet from the first moment, accepting her. And the last sentence is very important. The child mother, somehow the child is able to pick up these type of feelings. And so the child comes into the world as not accepted, as unwanted. And the book says large families are a joy for the church. St. John Paul II rightly explained that responsible parenthood does not mean unlimited procreation or a lack of awareness of what is involved in rearing children. So while the church says it's good to bring into the world as many children as God gives you as a gift, it's not important that you have large families, unlimited procreation, or a lack of awareness of what is involved in rearing children. We know what is happening in the West. Families don't want children. They consider children as a burden, as a hindrance to their freedom. And now they're facing the consequences. Germany opened the gates to migrants because there were no more young people who would work for them. And similarly in other countries, they don't find young people. So they want people to come from outside. So it is not unlimited procreation, but responsible parenthood. And then the book talks about pregnancy. Pregnancy is a difficult but wonderful time. And when a husband and wife can look upon pregnancy as a wonderful time, then that child in the womb will come out experiencing that wonder that the parents experience. The somatic traits of the person written in his or her genetic code already in the embryonic stage. So today's science allows us to, in a certain sense, understand that embryo, some of the somatic traits, what kind of a child you're going to have, whether you're going to have a boy, whether you're going to have a girl, how healthy the child is going to be, or whatever. Science permits this. But look at the next sentence. We love our children because they are children, not because they are beautiful or look or think as we do. So it's very important to accept the child as God is sending the child to the couple. In India, unfortunately, they don't like the girl child because of the dowry system and all that, it becomes a burden. So many of them get rid of the child if they know it's a girl. That's very bad. Sometimes they don't want a child who is mentally, physically challenged. A child who does not look as good as they would want that child. So this is what the Pope is saying. Okay? Do not take children just because they are beautiful or look or think as we do. I urge all future mothers. It's a very interesting point that the Pope is making here. During this time of pregnancy, for the woman especially, keep happy. Let nothing rob you of the interior joy of motherhood. Your unborn child requires your happiness. As I told you, the embryo in the womb picks up all the positive or the negative traits that you are going through. So let your pregnancy be joyful and pass that on to the unborn child. Don't let fears, worries, other people's comments, problems lessen your joy of being God's means for bringing new life into the world, so that you can pass it on to the child, the unborn child. See how keenly the Pope is pointing this out. So anything that is disturbing the mother during pregnancy is bad for the unborn child. So we need to take care of that. Okay, the love of a mother and a father. Children they get to receive the love shown to them through the gift of a personal name, the sharing of language, looks of love, and the brightness of a smile. Simple things, but it makes the child accepted. And such a child already begins a bond with the father and the mother. Every child has a right to receive love from a father and a mother. Both are necessary for a child's integral and harmonious development. Without this, a child will become, Pope uses a strong word, a mere play thing. So both are important, the father and the mother. Both have to make time for the child, so that the child is not just a pastime, but the child is really a possession that is treasured, that is precious, both for the father and the mother. And the Pope has a few things on this point. We cannot ignore the need that children have of a mother's presence, especially in the first 1 month of life. The weakening of the maternal presence with its feminine